fascism is a very rational system. It is a instrument by the ruling plutocracy to distract the people with the accoutrements of a false revolution. There's always a false populism, and there's a lot of goose-stepping, and there's a lot of manipulation of symbols and sentiments and love of the state and the like. Much of politics is the rational use of irrational symbols. So fascism, the attention that when people study Italian fascism or Nazism especially, they focus on it as a kind of insane movement that just happened, carried on by this maniac Adolf Hitler, and the Germans were just went out of their heads and were led astray. In fact, what they tried to do is direct the real grievances of the German people toward irrelevant enemies.
Die Parteien versprachen den Himmel auf Erden.
And when the fascists came into power, they cut wages by 50%, they destroyed every labor union, they destroyed every opposition party and every newspaper, closed them down. They abolished all inheritance taxes for the rich or cut them drastically. They abolished all cartel taxes for the corporations. Pretty much what's being done here, without having to go politically all that far. So fascism is an instrument whereby the plutocracy can control and effect, hopefully effect, a final solution to the class struggle. You totally shatter and destroy and enslave the working class, and people just have to take it. What substantiates what I just said, that fascism is an instrument of the plutocracy, is the way the plutocracy acted toward the fascists. Not just the German plutocracy, which gave Hitler enormous sums of money, which enabled him to go all over the country, but also the plutocracy of the United States, where all sorts of eminent members of that plutocracy openly supported the fascists.
He gave Harbin Industry, Allgemeine Elektricität Gesellschaft, Siemens Schuckenberger, Siemens Halske, Opel, Free Group Antigesellschaft, Tokyo Shibaura, Mitsubishi Electrical Engineering Company, Westinghouse Electric Company of Japan, Compagnia Generale di Elettricità, Margherini Società Anonima, and many more all over the world.
Among the titans of Wall Street, there was a tremendous amount of sympathy for Adolf Hitler and for Mussolini, coupled with a great deal of fear about what they perceived as a rising red threat and the threat from unions. So they were largely sympathetic with what they saw going on over there. And of course, these people and the attorneys working for them, like the Dulles brothers, who would later go on to run the State Department and the CIA, were very much in tune on this sort of thing. Put them in an awkward position, of course, later on when they ended up having to fight against Hitler. But that never really, I think, changed their fundamental belief, which was that they shared common cause with industrialists everywhere. In fact, many of these people were involved with companies that had operations in Germany and in occupied territories of Germany. We later saw the prosecution of a number of them under the Trading with the Enemy Act, and this included Prescott Bush, the grandfather of George W. Bush.
Prescott Bush was a partner in Brown Brothers Harriman, the most prestigious investment bank on Wall Street. At a time when the influence of the WASP establishment in America, the white Anglo-Saxon Protestants, was near its peak.
Not only did some of the most powerful corporations support fascism in Europe, so did many of its most powerful politicians. Mussolini was frequently praised by leading political figures in the United States and Britain, and even by Churchill himself. On January 20th, 1927, he lauded the new philosophy while on a trip to Italy. I will say a word on an international aspect of fascism, Churchill stated. Externally, your movement has rendered a service to the whole world. Italy has shown that there is a way of fighting the subversive forces which can rally the masses of the people, properly led, to value and wish to defend the honor and stability of civilized society. It was only when fascist states began threatening Anglo-American interests that the philosophy fell out of favor, at least temporarily. Working-class men and boys from around the world were now forced to either defend or combat the Frankenstein monster nurtured by elites within their own nations. The nightmare of World War II had begun.
General Eisenhower informs me that the forces of Germany have surrendered to the United Nations. The flags of freedom fly all over Europe.
Despite rhetoric to the contrary, Truman would support fascist and other totalitarian leaders across the globe. Republican Senator George Bender lamented that Mr. Truman has urged the Congress to authorize a program of military collaboration with all the petty and not-so-petty dictators of South America. Progressive politician Henry Wallace went further. He stated that bipartisan reactionary war policy would eventually lead to outright fascism in the United States itself. According to Wallace, the Cold War would lead to a century of fear.